Controversial government gift. President Joe Biden reveals a plan to cancel student debt for millions of Americans. Why politicians in both parties raise objections. Primary election results. A new Democrat vows to unseat Florida's Republican governor. Fears of genocide. Why some people accuse China of modern-day slavery. And full calendar. Learn what's on the Holy Father's to-do list as the end of summer draws near. On EWTN News Nightly for Wednesday, August 24th, 2022. Thank you so much for being with us tonight on this Feast of St. Bartholomew. I'm Tracy Sable. President Joe Biden generates some strong reaction with the announcement today that he wants to cancel a big chunk of student debt. We have team coverage. Eric Rosales explains why Republicans and some Democrats think it's a bad deal for taxpayers. But first, White House correspondent Owen Jensen tells us what's included in the proposal. Owen?
Tracy, good evening to you. President Joe Biden returned to the White House this morning from Rehoboth Beach, Delaware. And a short while later, he tweeted out his very controversial plan to get rid of some student debt. And then this afternoon, he went before the cameras.
President Joe Biden tells students burdened by big debt, help is coming.
All this means people can start finally crawl out from under that mountain of debt to get on top of their rent and their utilities. To finally think about buying a home or starting a family or starting a business.
The White House estimates the move, if it survives legal challenges, would wipe away the federal student debt of about 20 million people.
In the coming weeks, the Department of Education will lay out in detail a short and simple form to apply for this relief.
Earlier in the day, President Biden, in a tweet, laid out some specifics of his administration's student loan debt plan about who will get how much. $20,000 if you went to college on Pell Grants, $10,000 if you did not receive Pell Grants. It only applies to borrowers earning less than $125,000, and the student loan repayment pause extended through the end of the year. The White House released a fact sheet illustrating the problem. It shows the combined federal student loan debt is $1.6 trillion and rising. And in that same fact sheet, the White House says the plan will narrow the racial wealth gap, adding black students are more likely to have to borrow for school. But the Heritage Foundation, slamming the debt cancellation, tweeted, Joe Biden is robbing working Americans in order to pay off the college degrees of individuals who are statistically more likely to earn more in their lifetimes simply by possessing a college degree.
President Biden, you may recall, promised during his campaign he'd provide student debt cancellation, but critics contend his plan contradicts the Inflation Reduction Act and will cost the American taxpayer hundreds of billions of dollars. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
And our team coverage continues with Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales. He joins us now with reaction from lawmakers. Eric?
Well, good evening to you, Tracy. You know, what's interesting about this announcement, it comes less than 80 days before the midterm elections. It's a very popular subject with the younger generation, but Republicans say all it's going to do is benefit the wealthy, and all Democrats are trying to do is gain more votes.
A lot of taxpayers in this country, many of whom didn't go to college or have that opportunity, or many who chose to pay down their debt, subsidizing those who have student loans. I mean, it is crazy policy. It's an example, again, of some really radical far-left ideas that this administration has.
The Senate Minority Whip is not alone. Arkansas Senator Tom Cotton tweeted, Joe Biden has had a lot of bad ideas, but transferring billions in student loan debt to taxpayers, especially at a time of high inflation, might be his worst idea yet.
If you borrow money, you should pay it back. There's plenty of jobs out there. I borrowed money. I paid mine back. Why is it now that we don't do that for everybody?
Some Democrats also oppose the idea, but Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders tells me the president should go further, canceling all student debt.
There are millions of working class young people who are really paying a significant part of their incomes in student debt, and the result of that is that they are falling behind economically.
Florida Senator Rick Scott has another idea, one he says has worked before.
The most important thing we can do is get the cost of tuition down. So when I became governor of Florida, I stopped tuition increases, and by the time I left office, we had the lowest tuition of our university system in the country.
Annie tells me taxes will go up because someone else has to pay for it. And there's another issue.
The president hadn't made any distinction between people who can't pay and people who just don't want to pay. I think there's a better way to handle it than through these sort of across-the-board, one-size-fits-all moratoriums.
And reaction continues to pour in. Republican Senator John Barrasso just put out that he calls President Biden's announcement an insult to the hard Americans who worked hard to pay off all of their debts and did it right. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Well, a well-known congressman becomes Florida's Democratic candidate to recapture the governor's office. Charlie Crist will face incumbent Republican Ron DeSantis in the November election. Crist had served as the state's 44th governor as a Republican before stepping down in 2011. In another closely watched race, Congresswoman Val Demings won the Democratic nomination for U.S. Senate. She will challenge incumbent Republican Marco Rubio. And in New York, House Judiciary Committee Chairman Jerry Nadler defeated longtime colleague Carolyn Maloney. They competed for the same seat after redistricting merged their districts separately. Each party retained seats in two other congressional special elections. Democrat Pat Ryan defeated pro-life Republican Mark Molinaro, and Republican Joe Sempolinski defeated Democrat Max Della Pia. All right, now we go to Chris Bedford, co-founder of RightForge.com and senior editor at The Federalist. Chris, great to see you again. First off, I want to get your reaction to the president's student loan proposal, and also, what do you make of the timing?
I don't know exactly how legal it's going to end up being. It looks like this is a kind of proposal that was backed by a 9/11 era law that was designed to take care of U.S. soldiers and guardsmen who were having to leave colleges or leave behind loans to serve our country. It's the kind of thing that might get struck down by a judge, but either way, he's going to achieve kind of what he's looking for here, which is, well, potentially he could achieve that, which is trying to gin up some enthusiasm with his base and say, I tried. And if he gets knocked down, even all the better for him, because that way he can point toward the evil courts and the Mitch McConnell courts, et cetera, to try and get his base ginned up. So far, I'm not exactly sure how it's going. The president of the NAACP has attacked it as a handout that takes away from black people, particularly black women, he said. And it's certainly something that benefits people who have graduate degrees, for example, much more disproportionately to anyone else in this country. I do think it's certainly a political play to try and get the base ginned up. We'll see exactly where it goes. If handing out free candy, this might be one of the only things in D.C. where the free candy actually makes some enemies for you.
Chris, I'm curious, if this does move forward, ultimately, what do you think this will do to our economy, and what type of impact do you think it will have on higher education moving forward?
Well, it's just continue the burgeoning of the higher education, which is something that's really destroying our economy. The United States has built a completely fraudulent credit system where everybody gets rich except for our actual graduates and our people. A lot of these colleges are unanswerable to how well their students do ever. They keep on taking this money, their endowments continue. And if this goes through as currently designed, we're going to be back to the exact same problem in merely 4 years. You have to actually go after the root of this. And government just trying to cancel debt or make monopoly money out of this is not going to help that. You have to tackle these colleges and the question of why so much taxpayer money is going toward private institutions in the first place, institutions that have so many billions of dollars in reserve in the first place. That's something that Republicans and Democrats who have a more popular streak ought to be looking at. Why do these universities and colleges seem to undermine our economy, undermine our students, and undermine, if you're a conservative or a Christian, your political or religious beliefs every single year while receiving money hand over fist from the taxpayer?
On a different note, yesterday a number of midterm elections were held, including in Florida, where Governor Ron DeSantis, a pro-life Republican, will now face Charlie Crist, a former Florida governor. Your thoughts on that?
This is something that's gotten the Washington Post and CNN very excited that Ron DeSantis is going to go down because they pulled out former Republican and serial loser Charlie Crist to try and run against him. I don't see it going anywhere so far. It seems like something that they're getting very excited about, but Ron DeSantis wasn't on the ballot for this. He's a massively popular Republican governor. The amount of Republicans in that state has increased year over year to the highest point it's ever been, and the first time it's ever been the largest group of people in Florida's history, at least as far as they've been looking back at that, at those numbers. And Charlie Crist began his campaign saying, "I don't want your vote if you're a Ron DeSantis voter. I don't want you because you have hate in your heart." That seems like something that could be a messaging campaign for attacking and undermining DeSantis potentially before a White House bid. But it's not the kind of thing you say if you want to be the governor of a state.
We have about 30 seconds left or so, Chris, but I want to touch on this before I let you go. Earlier this week, Dr. Anthony Fauci announced that he will be stepping down and retiring in December. What do you make of his announcement and also the timing of it?
Well, Mitch McConnell might think that there's no chance Republicans take the Senate. I disagree with him, and apparently so does Anthony Fauci. He's someone who certainly wants to. He's old, of course. He's made a lot of money, and he's made a lot of impact, at least in the fields he wants to. But I suspect that he strongly wants to avoid the investigative arm of people like Senator Rand Paul should they come to power the following month.
All right, we're going to leave it right there. Chris, thank you so much, as always, for weighing in. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, the United States confirms that it carried out airstrikes in Syria targeting Iranian-backed militias operating in the country.
We've always said we will take action whenever, wherever necessary to defend our interests, to defend our personnel. Our personnel have come under repeated attack by Iran-backed elements in the region. What the president ordered overnight was a proportional, decisive operation.
A video reportedly shows the impact site and resulting flames from the U.S. airstrikes. A group monitoring the war says the strikes killed at least six Syrian and foreign militants. While Israel's prime minister is also expressing grave concerns about Iran, he says the nuclear deal being considered by the U.S. and other countries does not meet the standards set by President Biden himself. U.S. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan met with his counterpart from Israel this week and promised the United States would continue to preserve and strengthen Israel's capability to deter its enemies and defend itself. Well, Ukraine's president says that his country is in a new era.
Нам важко, але ми стиснули кулаки і вигризаємо свою долю.
Volodymyr Zelensky spoke on Ukraine's national holiday marking its independence from the then Soviet Union. He said Russia's invasion, which began 6 months ago, was unprovoked and promised to reclaim regions now under Russia's control. Ukraine also blames Russia for a rocket attack today that killed at least 15 people at a train station in the central part of that country. Coming up, raising flags. What an online review site is saying about pro-life pregnancy centers. Plus, a new report accuses China of forced labor against a religious minority. First Lady Jill Biden has once again tested positive for COVID-19. Her office says that she will remain in Delaware during this rebound case and added the First Lady is not experiencing any symptoms. The White House says the president has tested negative. Well, a federal judge in Texas is temporarily blocking a Health and Human Services guidance on abortion. It involves a law that requires emergency care for pregnant women without concern for payment. HHS wanted to include abortion as a service. The ruling says the HHS guidance went beyond the law's purpose. The White House criticizes the decision. On the online side, Yelp is beginning a new policy to flag pro-life clinics. It is imposing a critical warning message on listings for crisis pregnancy centers. Their wording suggests that pro-life clinics misrepresent themselves about abortion and abortion services. Well, a new report says China's mistreatment of the Uyghur religious minority amounts to, quote, modern-day slavery. The special report was commissioned by the United Nations. It cites the use of forced labor in agriculture and manufacturing in one region in the northwest part of the communist country. Beijing says that it is merely providing work opportunities for the minority population. And we go now to Nori Turkel, chair of the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. Nori, great to have you on. Let's talk more about this report. I'm curious, what struck you the most about it?
The report has actually validated what has been reported already by various media organizations. NGO reports, even the reports published by U.S. Congress and the State Department. So this is something not new to the general public. I hope that we can translate this into a real action. A lot of concerns being expressed on a societal level, governmental level, but where is the action? Why to this day there's no single company that includes companies like Nike, Coca-Cola, Heinz Ketchup, and others, not even admitting publicly that there's a human rights abuses, let alone acknowledging the ongoing genocide against the Uyghur people. You know, when you look back, the global responses after Putin's invasion of Ukraine, a significant number of global businesses either suspended or pulled out of Russia. It took several days. But for the Chinese Communist Party's orchestrated slave labor practices, even to this day, even the genocide in its sixth year, there's no single company even mildly acknowledged that they have a problem in China in the business practices. So the corporate America, global businesses need to get onto the right side of the history. They are not helping. The governmental action only take us to a certain place, but it's not going to completely resolve the problem. The other piece is, now this is UN acknowledged practices, modern-day slavery. I call on and urge European community, European Parliament, and the member states to put in place legislative mandate like the way that our government has done through Uyghur Forced Labor Prevention Act to address this modern-day slavery. And modern-day slavery is enslavement of vulnerable religious ethnic groups is something that we have seen in the history. And now we're letting this history to repeat because of our addiction to cheap consumer products coming from China and filling up our homes and stores. So essentially, the global community, global consumer community, in a way, fueling this political economy that is linked to the modern-day slavery, where China has polluted global supply chain with slave-made products.
Nori, we talked about the forced labor, and we've talked about the Uyghurs on this program before with you. For those maybe this is new to them, learning about it, I also want to talk about other reports of forced sterilization and late-term abortions being performed on Uyghur women, that is, over in China. What more can you tell us about these atrocities?
One of the most harrowing aspects of the ongoing genocide involves women and children. Today, the Chinese authorities, through direct or indirect involvement of people's private lives, the ability to have a normal family life, an ability to conceive a child, has been controlled by the Chinese government. I recently published a book. In my book, I have a chapter specifically discussing China's war on Uyghur women. In it, I have profiled the Uyghur camp victims, camp survivors, telling me a horrifying stories that they have to take this mysterious pill to control their period. They also control their emotion. They control their ability to get pregnant. In one instance, one of my survivors told me that she was forced to sterilize, even though she's over 50 years old, and had no plan to get pregnant. And even by China's own admission, there's a significant drop in the natural population growth. In just one year, we're talking about 65% in one county. Mm-hmm. So this is an unspeakable truth that the international community that had to come to grip with and came to face with this brutal reality. And then the other pieces involving children, based on various reports, the Chinese government is operating a modern-day children's camp through boarding schools. They have an innocuous name that they have locked up children, a significant number of children. We're talking about 800,000 to 1 million, as reported in the New York Times.
It's such a horrible situation over there, Nori. And we really thank you for coming on and shining a light on this. I wish we had more time. We'll have to get you back on again so we can delve a little further to it. But thank you so much for talking with us, and thank you for all that you do.
Thank you.
Up next, Pope Francis prepares for a busy weekend ahead. What's on his agenda? Plus,
the Holy Father's encouragement about the promises of heaven. Pope Francis has ordered every entity in the Holy See to move their funds to the Vatican Bank. The request is part of the Holy Father's reforms for the Holy See's governing bodies. The transfers are expected to be completed by the end of September. Pope Francis is preparing for a busy end of summer in the Vatican. The Holy Father will return to private audiences starting tomorrow, while there will be two important events over the weekend, a consistory at the Vatican and the first apostolic visit to an Italian city in 2022. Joining us now from Rome is Andreas Tannhauser, EWTN Vatican Bureau Chief. Andreas, great to see you. So it seems that vacation time at the Vatican is over.
Yes, Tracy, absolutely right. Summer vacations are definitely over, at least for the Holy Father and for the Vatican officials. Pope Francis has a jam-packed schedule in the days ahead. We'll be, of course, reporting on it, especially on the consistory and on his one-day trip to Aquila. Both are taking place this weekend. The consistory is of particular interest because there are 20 cardinals that will be newly created, such as Bishop Robert McElroy of San Diego. And as is widely known, the selection of these cardinals has raised many eyebrows amongst experts, not only here in Rome, because more logical candidates basically have been ignored. Very unexpected choices, so to say. And then, also in 3 weeks, Pope Francis will be traveling to Kazakhstan for a three-day visit. And there, he is expected to meet with Patriarch Kirill of Moscow, which is the head, of course, of the Russian Orthodox Church. Now, this meeting has been anticipated basically since the invasion of Ukraine of Ukraine by Russian forces. And the Patriarch consistently defended President Putin's actions. There is some hope that a meeting between the Patriarch and Pope Francis could be what could become the first step towards the end of this very violent war that we are experiencing here in Europe.
And Andreas, you talked about the Holy Father's trip to Aquila. What more can you tell us about that?
Well, so about this trip, lately any resignation rumors over this trip have ceased. Pope Francis has made it a point to show to the world that he is actually of good health, and he insisted at several occasions actually that he's not thinking about resignation, at least not at the moment. Those rumors were primarily sparked because of his rather spontaneous visit to Aquila, which is planned for the coming Sunday. And this is a town also in central Italy that has a history with popes resigning. In 1294, Pope Celestine V, he stepped down from his office in this town. Only after 5 months of being a pope, he wanted to return to his life as an ermite. This all happened there in Aquila, Tracy, and combined with the reports on the pope's health, as well as with this spontaneous trips, there were more and more rumors that the pope might be thinking about resigning as well. But his interviews, his travel plans, and even the daily schedule now, they all speak a different language. For example, also tomorrow, Pope Francis will receive the president of Hungary, Katalin Novak. And by the way, this is, at least for Europeans, a rather interesting encounter because of the government of Viktor Orban. His government has been heavily criticized by the European Union because of its stance on family and marriage. And only recently the European Union wanted to take or plans to take steps against the country because the country has passed new legislation banning LGBTQ propaganda in public schools. And Katalin Novak, she will also probably participate in the meeting of international Catholic legislators, which is taking here at this place where I'm right now outside of Rome.
Well, Andreas, thank you so much for that report today. We really appreciate it. Andreas Tannhauser, EWTN Vatican Bureau Chief. Thank you again. Pope Francis reminds the faithful that our goals and our focus in everything we do should be about reaching heaven.
Gesù, quando parla del regno di Dio, lo descrive come un pranzo di nozze.
As weekly talk to pilgrims at the Vatican, the Holy Father also praised the elderly, saying most people become wiser and smarter only as they grow older. Pope Francis also said that we should look forward to our life after death because the risen body is 1,000 times more alive than what we experience here on earth. Well, we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.